Madam Rector Magnificus, Mr. Dean, members of the Curational Panel of the Special Chair of Water Governance, members of the Rectorate of UNESCO IHE, dear friends, family, colleagues. In the not-so-distant past, choosing a career as a water expert was among the obvious choices when one had the aspiration to become a hero. Water engineering education, granted its bearer, provided he was white and male, but that went without saying, with the scientific credentials, as well as the moral superiority to reshape large areas of land and alter the courses of rivers in the name of progress and modernity. Referring to Dutch engineers working in Indonesia, Ravenstein wrote that they, and I quote, were involved in a heroic struggle to conquer challenging tropical water streams. They did this far away from home, in a deadly climate, and in circumstances that were also extremely harsh otherwise. Especially the pioneers among the builders of monuments were true heroes in the eyes of later generations of engineers. Men like Wilcox and Cotton in India and Egypt, De Bruyn in Indonesia, Van der Heide in Siam, and many others maintain a glorious existence in the memories of today's water engineers. In statues raised in their honor at the intakes of irrigation systems they originally designed, as well as in historical accounts of their accomplishments. Also in the Netherlands, many would agree that water engineers, men like Cornelis Nely and Johan van Veen, have laid the foundations for the country's current modernity and prosperity. Some would even argue that a small group of water engineers, together with Thorbecke, made the Netherlands what it is today. As Auke van der Wout shows, the construction of and management of new and huge infrastructural works designed and constructed by these engineers demanded and went accompanied with parallel transformations in law and governance, thus laying the basis for the entire organization of the Dutch state, and some would say, forming the essence of Dutch identity and culture in the process. The continued appeal of these stories lies in how they combine ideas about the malleability of society, ideas that it is possible to control, design, and reshape landscapes, water flows, as well as societies, with comforting beliefs in the existence of visionary, courageous, and intelligent leaders, men to whom we can delegate the responsibility to look after our waters. Men, in short, who will look after us. Today's water problems are not less challenging than those of the past. The oft-repeated reminders that increases in rates of use and extraction are by far exceeding levels of population growth, declarations of water crisis as the top threat of the next decade, for instance in the recent World Economic Forum, estimates of the billions of people who in the not-so-far future will live in areas plagued by water scarcity, accounts of how climate change is endangering the water and food security of many of the world's poorest people, the proliferation of water-related conflicts, reports about droughts in Sao Paulo or the San Joaquin Valley in California, and I could go on, all make water into one of the more prominent topics on contemporary political agendas. Some argue that because of their urgency, solving water problems requires new water wizards and heroes, new courageous visionaries who speak and act on behalf of nature and society. I am much less sure that new water heroes are possible and desirable. Disappointment about the lack of hospitality of the water profession to women, because of course I would have liked to be one of these heroes, and feminist misgivings of father figures and of men who use generic wisdoms to speak and act on behalf of both society and nature may partly explain this. But my reservations about the desirability of new water heroes are also linked to the realization that the meanings of the terms water and knowledge have radically changed over the past 30 to 40 years. in the process also altering the terms of existence for water heroes. I would like to use my lecture today for a reflection on the implications of these changes for ways of knowing and intervening in water, for ways of thinking and doing water governance. My effort here can perhaps be likened to the making of a rough sketch of the contours and coordinates of today's water governance questions, a sketch that forms the starting point for producing a map, or more likely, a set of maps, each with their own legends, colors, and scales, to lay out the areas and domains in which contemporary water experts and professionals navigate and operate. I have two important starting points and motivations for this exercise. The first is concern about the equity and sustainability of prevailing water distributions. And the second is the recognition that water governance is always contested and disputed. I use my lecture, in other words, to explore ways of engaging with water governance that acknowledge and appreciate, rather than conceal, that it is always deeply political. Let me first say something about how the meanings of water as an object of knowledge and intervention have changed in the last decades. There are at least three sets of changes. First, different from the golden era of the hydraulic mission, today's dealings with water no longer just are about the development and construction of new projects. Instead, they are about how to save and conserve water and allocate it among competing uses and users. This shift is associated with the closure of river basins and with the so-called green turn, a radical reappraisal of the importance of the environment, nature, both for its own sake as well as for the services and values it provides to society, a turn that is captured in phrases like building with nature or room for the river. Concerns about the water-related consequences of climate change, floods, droughts, extreme weather events, are introducing further changes in the meanings of water, with terms like fear, risk, uncertainty becoming an ever more familiar part of water vocabularies. A second important change is that where water development and management used to be the exclusive realm of state agency, water is now governed by a multitude of actors and parties. Alongside a shift in managerial attention from the infrastructure to the resource, and increasingly from the resource to the ecosystem, there is a paradoxical decentralization of responsibilities to private companies and civil society organizations. Free markets, or market mechanisms, are now increasingly relied upon for effectively and efficiently allocating water among competing users and users, while private sector actors are expected to mobilize the funds needed for constructing new water infrastructures, as well as to manage or operate water resources and systems, and provide water-related services in an efficient manner. The meanings of water citizenship are changing in the process. Instead of participation in the public realm, consumption in the private realm becomes its defining feature. Water management and governance processes and procedures thus become redefined and restructured, blurring the very distinctions between private and public, or between formal and informal. A third and related set of changes is that water increasingly crosses administrative and national boundaries. This happens in at least two ways. First, although actual water distributions happen at local and basin levels, they are ever more subject to the dynamics of the global economy. The almost 5,000 liters that it takes to produce a hamburger is just one example. That I can go to my supermarkets and buy grapes that were cultivated in the desert of Maharashtra is another, or mangoes on the desert coast of Peru is yet another. A second way in which water governance jumps scales is that water problems are increasingly seen as being global in nature. A new global water regime is emerging, a regime that, through the use of specific conceptual languages and forms of expertise, links the treatment of water as a scarce and therefore economic good to forms of representation and calculation that make its meanings and values commensurable across places and times. These three sets of questions set the scene for how current water-related problems and questions are perceived and addressed, and for how solutions are proposed or contested. Although competition for water is increasing, the question of who is responsible for making allocation priorities or steering distributions is becoming ever less clear, while precise information about the nature and direction of water flows is often lacking. Through the combined effect of multiple new, in particular private sector actors, invisible and globalizing market-based allocation mechanisms, and global policy institutes and directives, questions of how to democratically control water decisions and of whom to hold responsible for them are becoming ever less transparent and more complex. Alongside and linked to these changes in the meanings of water, ideas about what it means to know water have also undergone changes. In the past, engineers and scientists were seen as talking value-free truth to power. Indeed, the authority and legitimacy of water scientists and engineers importantly rested on the perceived division of labor between academia, markets, and politics. Now, this idea is making place for new ones, which acknowledge how knowledge, power, markets, and politics are mixed in ways that are difficult to disentangle. Attempts to theorize and think through the implications of these entanglements are producing new definitions of water and water problems, new ontologies, as well as proposals for new ways of organizing processes of knowledge production. Many of the newly proposed ontological divisions aspire to capture the idea that nature and society are not two distinct phenomena or processes or domains, but instead are always implied in each other. Hence, rather than explaining the behavior of water by referring to some natural watery essence, a hydrological core, and explaining the behavior of people by referring to some humanist essence, emerging theorizations propose considering water and people in their mutual interactions, positing that they exist and indeed are because of and through each other. This interdependence is mediated by technologies, institutions, and labor, as well as by words, languages, and discourses, laws, norms, beliefs, cosmologies. One of the useful but also puzzling effects of such definitions is that they shift questions from the indisputable domains of nature, biology, or technology, domains that are only accessible by an exclusive group of experts, to the contingent domain of society and politics. This opens them up for debate, widens definitions of expertise, and increases the number of experts. Water scholars, for instance, propose terms like waterscapes, hydrosocial networks, or hydrosocial cycles to express that the growing pressures on water resources, as well as the resulting scarcities, are not natural processes, but the outcome of specific histories and practices of water resources exploitation and development. New definitions of water and water problems go accompanied with new ways of expressing what scientists do. Where scientists were seen to discover realities and the laws of nature or societies, new ways of speaking say that scientists construct or even produce or perform them, and that knowing is intervening in and direct material engagement with the world. Or, rather than representing the world as it is, emerging ways of indicating what knowledge is talk about performance or enactment. Such terms express that knowledge is always based on prior identifications, assumptions, and specific boundary conditions, and linked to specific histories, cultures, and socio-material projects. This does not mean that anything goes, or that it becomes impossible to judge less from more accurate knowledges. but it does mean that developing awareness of and becoming accountable for the choices inherent in cherished ways of knowing and intervening becomes itself an important feature of good science. Which possibilities for being and relating do specific orderings, categorizations, taxonomies, abstractions create, and for whom? And which ones do they foreclose? Are alternative modes of ordering possible? Where the defining features of scientific truth and objectivity used to be universality, detachment, and transcendence, new norms of objectivity talk about engagement and situatedness, or pragmatically define truth as that what works. Social studies of science and engineering have shown that the production of water facts happens in specific places by specific people who have identities, bodies, cultures, and interests. To make scientific facts travel, or to help them become mobile, generic, and universal, requires hard work of the actors involved. Part of this work is performative and has to do with packaging them in languages, clothes, shapes, and forms that are recognized and appreciated as carriers of truth. A white male body may help, for instance, provided the person performing that body behaves according to specific historical and cultural gender scripts. In short, rather than making difficult political questions disappear from scientific debate by treating science and politics as different domains, new proposals for developing scientific knowledge aspire to explicitly acknowledge and deal with the entanglements between science and politics, or science and society. These changes in water as an object of knowledge and in ways of knowing water that I just sketched form the background of the research agenda that I would like to propose. Together, they are prompting a reconsideration of what water problems are and according to whom, about how they can be known and solved, and about how processes of water decision-making are or should be coordinated and organized. Motivated by concerns about environmental justice, I like to read them as questions about water distributions, distributions of water and of water-related rights, risks, responsibilities, benefits, and incomes, as well as distributions of scientific or political voice, power, and authority. Many existing studies of water assume or prescribe rather than question and investigate such distributions and their linkages. This is partly a reflection of the instrumental and engineering nature of much water knowledge. And it is linked to the fact that water experts are trained and requested to diagnose problems in ways that match the kind of solutions that fall within their repertoire. As my colleague Peter van der Zaag always says, we have the solutions, now we have to find the problems that match them. Yet, thinking and analyzing in terms of solutions performs water realities in distinct ways. Something that Tanya Lee refers to as rendering technical. Rendering technical simultaneously renders non-political. It places questions of distributions and of the societal orders these presume and produce outside of what is debatable. I prefer not to start inquiries into distributions from ideas and assumptions about what and how they are or should be. Instead, I propose to make the questions about the what, how, and why of distributions the very center of the study of water governance. By doing this, I intend to open them up for debate and dialogue. How do distributions happen? Through which technological, institutional, and organizational arrangements? And how are and can they be known, made intelligible? Studies of distributions are studies of how connections are made, but also of how divisions and choices happen, and about how they come about through the cultural production of difference. Before I continue, allow me to share some stories of water distributions with you. To create some impression of logic, I have categorized these stories in three: distributions of water, distributions of voice and authority, and distributions of knowledge and expertise. The water distributions that I am currently trying to make sense of concern the transfers of water that are taking place in many rural regions of the world from lower value food crops to higher value commercial crops or other higher priority uses, industries, cities. Such transfers are actively promoted as attempts to improve the productivity and efficiency of water used in agriculture, or to save, conserve water, to either quench the thirst of growing cities and industries, or protect ecosystems and future flows or stocks. They are made legally possible through the drastic reformulation of agricultural water rights and justified by the dubious characterization of existing rural water uses as non-productive and wasteful. How to understand such reallocations? How do they happen? And what do they mean for the possibilities of different groups of people to make a living, accumulate wealth, or indeed develop? Different studies suggest different possible scenarios. One possible scenario comes from the study of Milagros Sosa about mining companies in Peru. On the face of it, this appears to be an almost classical case of dispossession and proletarization, with highland subsistence farmers selling their land and water to the mining company to themselves become wage laborers. Although employment is insecure, wages are often higher than what they would have earned as campesinos. They also receive what for them are high prices when selling their land and water. These improvements in incomes are much appreciated. The mining company also invests a lot in roads, schools, and hospitals, effectively improving living conditions, health, and well-being. Yet, the campesino families are less happy with the often irrevocable changes in livelihoods and environments that mining companies also provoke. In particular, the changes in the quantity and quality of water flows caused by mining operations have generated and continue to generate fierce and sometimes violent protests. The possibilities and powers campesinos have to hold the mining company accountable to its water actions are very limited. This is because of their economic dependence on the mining company, but also because the mining company has become the de facto water manager in the area. It acquired the power to do so through its investments in water reservoirs. The physical control of water that these make possible form the basis of its managerial powers of control. In addition, formal accountability relations are mainly directed upwards, with the company having to comply with national and international regulations on the basis of technical information, much of it of which it produces itself, rather than having to explain what it does and why to the people who directly experience the implications of their actions. This, by the way, could be likened to the same public management style that characterizes the governance of many Dutch universities and that the protesters are currently protesting against next door, with efficiencies and quantifiable indicators of output becoming more important than experiences and opinions of students, researchers and lecturers. The Saïs in Morocco is another rural area that is witnessing rapid changes from low to higher value uses, changes that form part of larger rural transformations actively promoted by the government as part of its Plan Maroc Vert. Detailed studies of the everyday practices of irrigation and farming by Maya Benounich, Lisa Bossenbroek and Saskia van der Kooi shed an interesting light on how changes in water distributions and in access and rights to water happen through a combination of land transfers, new technologies, and the renegotiation of farmers' relations with each other and with the government and private sector actors. From some distance, it is possible to see contemporary Moroccan reforms and reallocations as processes of accumulation by dispossession, with the privatization of cooperative lands allowing new investors to acquire the land and water rights they need for profitable production. Indeed, the changes appear to favor those who are considered productive and economically efficient, some modern men, while forcing those who do not meet these criteria of modernity, including traditional women, to look for other livelihood opportunities, for instance, by working as wage laborers on the lands their parents used to own. When zooming in, however, the enormous diversity of farming styles and modes of organizing farming production and of irrigation methods, organizations, and technologies is striking. Fitting this diversity with neat Marxist or modernist categories or teleologies is not just difficult, but also would fail to do justice to the creativity and experiences of those living these changes. Whatever one's frame of explanation, it is obvious that the new, often more capital-intensive modes of production restructure labor and tenure relations and livelihoods at material as well as discursive levels in ways that are significantly marked by existing social hierarchies and institutions. Gender is one such institution and an all-pervading one. New modes of farming, for instance, are leading to the professionalization and masculinization of farming identities, offering new and exciting opportunities for some young men to combine the activity of modern farming with new ideals of modern manhood. Young men picture their future selves as white-collar, clean-shaven entrepreneurs who operate their drip systems from their mobile phones while walking in the souk. Opportunities for young women are much more restricted and less exciting, because the same professionalization of farming is gradually leading to stronger spatial and symbolic distinctions between the private home, women's domain, and the public work, men's domain. Now you might wonder, as are these still stories about water governance? I think they are. For one, they show that water redistributions are not neatly contained in a water domain. They are intrinsic to and help produce wider changes. In Peru, as well as in Morocco, rapid processes of agrarian change and economic growth happen alongside with and partly depend on new modes of accessing and distributing water that are only partly the result of conscious water policies or management decisions, and may sometimes even go against them. The stories also usefully show that how and to whom water flows cannot be easily deduced from formal policies and legislation. Instead, water distributions occur through often messy, multi-layered, and multiple transactions and negotiations in which power, identity, and politics are important. These stories automatically also raise questions about how water voice and authorities are distributed. How do the described water transfers reshuffle and rearrange powers and responsibilities for decision-making? How are possibilities to steer and somehow control distributions of water coordinated and organized? Whom to approach or hold accountable if water distributions are unjust or unsustainable? Or where or to whom to go with expert advice for improving water governance? The above examples, to which I could add all the examples collected by my colleagues about urban water governance, illustrate that water decisions and actions occur in complex environments in which numerous social actors strategize with varying degrees of influence and certainty. These actors do not only have widely differing perspectives and interests, but are also drawing on different resources, norms, and legal repertoires to articulate, frame, and defend their positions. Acknowledging this prompts modesty in terms of what can be changed or improved and how fast, and forces thinking about governance away from a still predominant rationalist model of institutional and policy reform. What, for instance, if de facto control over how water is used and allocated is coming to lie with international companies? As is the case of the Yanacocha gold mine in Cajamarca I just discussed. These companies often appear to be more accountable to their overseas headquarters and the final clients of their products than to governments or people in the regions where they operate. Possibilities to influence the behavior of these companies are limited and also ironic. They mostly consist of corporate social responsibility mechanisms and stewardship certifications, with the standards set by the dominant market players themselves, such as the Global GAP board members, who are all representatives of major producers or supermarket chains. And there's not much these schemes can do to modify actual water flows. They can try and prescribe norms about rational water use, however, and perhaps unless when contained in networks, and even then, measuring amounts and qualities of water is time-consuming and expensive. It is also never completely straightforward, because the outcomes of measurements depend on when and where they were done and on scalar assumptions used. One way for agribusiness companies to show that they efficiently and rationally deal with water is by using drip irrigation systems. The use of drip irrigation is used as a proxy indicator for efficient and therefore responsible water use. Yet, the relation between the use of drip irrigation systems and efficiency is contentious on many accounts, with increases in efficiency often entailing reallocations of water rather than net water savings. Studies show that the spread of drip irrigation, although promoted on grounds of sustainability, water conservation, often happens because of commercial reasons. The sale of drip systems is a very profitable exercise, business, or because drips allow saving labor, facilitate operations, or ironically, expand areas irrigated. The mere use of the technology, therefore, says very little about the wisdom with which water is used or distributed. One obvious lesson here is that labels or certificates meant to convince that the product you are buying is produced in water-wise ways should be treated with suspicion. Another is that attention to actual flows and the actual operations of water systems and technologies are important when trying to understand water distributions. Water is notoriously capricious and seldom conforms to rules or regulations. These stories of distributions of water and of voice in authority are closely linked to stories of knowing and intervening in them. As noted, ways of knowing and forms of expertise are always part of distributional orders rather than external to them. There's much to say about this. Here, let me just reiterate that awareness of how all water knowledge comes from somewhere, is local, makes the question of how knowledge travels a pertinent one. The superiority of scientific expertise cannot be taken for granted. Instead, it is necessary to continuously ask why some knowledges are more mobile and carry greater authority than others. How is it that the networks for some types of water expertise and for some water experts have acquired much wider extension than others? Why, for instance, is it that so-called scientific measurements of changes in water qualities and quantities carry greater weight in assessing the environmental behavior of the Yanacocha mining company of Milagros' study than the experiences of the people living these changes? In the official and scientific endorsed accounts of these changes, canals constructed by campesinos mysteriously disappear. These accounts also conveniently dismiss visual testimonies of deteriorating qualities of water, such as yellowing pastures or sick cows. Here, my point is not that mining companies or scientists are lying. Rather, I want to illustrate that realities are performed or enacted in specific historical, cultural, and material practices, linking them to specific histories and futures. Approaching realities as enacted and multiple shifts the terms of the debate away from the question of which knowledge is most accurate to the question of what makes it durable and mobile. Such questions about the durability and mobility of knowledge can also be asked more generally. Why, for instance, is calling water knowledge Dutch a marker of its quality, mobility, and exportability, whereas calling it Ghanaian or Indonesian would denote it as local and specific? When reflecting about the relevance of the Institute, my colleagues at UNESCO IHE produced a number of slides which clearly illustrate that most water science is produced in northern countries, even when it is science about water problems in the south. The slides signal the need for more southern water scientists, thus underscoring the relevance of the Institute. They can, however, also be read as visualizations of a particular colonial tradition of scientific knowledge production, forcefully prompting the question, which and whose knowledges matter and count, and on which grounds? These are questions about truth, but at the same time, these are questions about how powers of authority come about and are performed. Drawing on these stories, the definition of water governance that I would like to propose is the practices of coordination and decision-making between different actors around contested water distributions. Such practices are thick with politics and culture, are linked to creative processes of imagining and producing collective environmental futures, and combine political problems of scale with problems of coherence. I would like to be particularly attentive to four topics or themes. First, as I already suggested, I would like to dedicate explicit attention to the linkages between governance processes and outcomes. With this, I do not mean to already include ideas about what outcomes should be in definitions of governance, but I am interested in defining what good governance is or should be beyond process indicators, such as transparency, accountability, participation, integrity. This is because I'm afraid that good governance might produce not good outcomes, or vice versa. And I therefore think that it's important that the linkages between process and outcomes are made the topic of investigation rather than assumed. Second, I would like to create explicit space and attention to how water governance arrangements, decisions, and procedures are always deeply material. They are shaped by, while in turn shaping, technologies and ecologies and bodies. Or, rather than confining governance questions to the domain of the social sciences and treating them as being merely about the social, I would like to build and further develop ways of grappling with water that are attentive to the interdependencies and co-evolutions between technologies, natures, and societies. A careful and detailed consideration of and respect for how technologies work and are operated, and of how waters behave is important here. Third, I would like to help create further intellectual space for recognizing and understanding how water governance is not just about the organization of decision-making with respect to water, but also about the production of social order via the administration of water. How do specific distributions of water depend on and help produce specific societal orderings? And how can changes in water governance help produce more equitable and sustainable societies? These questions include explicit attention to the entanglements between scientific orders, taxonomies, scales, frames, discourses, and water societal ones, in an attempt to nurture reflexive forms of public water expertise that embrace engagement instead of detachment. And fourth, I would like to devote explicit attention to the exploration of scientific and policy dealings with distributions, and of how these travel through time and space. For instance, in the form of models, guidelines, or technologies. Results of such explorations will form the basis for developing forms of reflexivity or critique that will be important features for new water scientists and ways of knowledge production. I consider ethnographic accounts of everyday practices of distribution and of knowing them a useful empirical basis from which to embark on the proposed studies. A focus on practices entails dealing with the doings and sayings of those involved in the mundane and everyday dealings with water. Hence, rather than just approaching debates on distributions in terms of universals, neoliberalism, capitalism, liberal environmentalism, patriarchy, evolution, I think there is merit in attending to them through detailed studies of the messy, heterogeneous, and worldly encounters through and in which they happen, are justified and contested. Next to an emerging body of practice-based work on the governance of nature, the idea developed by Tsing that it is through contingent worldly encounters, Tsing proposes the metaphor of friction, that universals are brought into action, is an important source of inspiration here. Results of the kind of studies that I propose will yield accounts of the many and diverse ways in which water distributions happen and are done, and of the many different ways they can be understood and assessed. There will be resonances between these accounts, but also gaps and frictions. Instead of new fundamentals and essences, comparing them will produce contrasts, shadows and highlights, fractional coherences, oscillations, interferences, interactions, showing the makeshift links across distance and difference that allow some of them to travel. To return to where I started, what does all this say about the terms of existence for water heroes? Beliefs in old and new water heroes are implicitly based on the picture of water decision-making as a pyramid-shaped hierarchy, with some all-seeing and all-knowing authority sitting at its top. In this picture, the role of water heroes, engineers or scientists, is that of using their expertise to assist the omniscient high-level decision-makers in making the right decisions. There are two assumptions here. The first is that the building blocks of what scientists and engineers want to change are permanent and can be straightforwardly uncovered by sound and systematic scientific investigation. The second is that water decision-making has a clearly identifiable center or head. In my talk, I have challenged both assumptions. Water expertise is deeply entangled with politics and markets, while water governance is polycentric, or perhaps centerless. This is why I think it is doubtful whether the new water experts that are needed will ever assume the same heroic status as our grandfathers. My conclusion is that it may in fact be better to entirely let go of hopes that such new heroes will ever emerge. Their existence implies and produces a dangerous concentration of knowledge, power and authority. Old and new heroes should in fact be treated with suspicion. Instead, solving today's water problems requires the burgeoning of many different kinds of knowledge and many different knowing identities and cultures. It entails accepting that these knowledges and knowers will never be easily reconciled. And it means being pragmatic about the negotiations and struggles that knowing and dealing with water entails. Rather than confident finalities and masterful knowing, perhaps pleasures of friendliness, trust, and companionable connections are better guides to develop new modes of engaging with and intervening in water. Modes that are modest and open to unpredictabilities, contingencies, and the limits of understanding. Friends, colleagues, beloved ones, I have come to the end of my talk, and I would like to use the remaining minutes to express a few words of thanks. First of all, I would like to thank the Executive Board of University of Amsterdam and the Dean of the Faculty of Behavioral Sciences for offering me this opportunity to become, for the first time in my academic life, part of a real social science environment. So far, the interactions with my many new colleagues in the Governance and Inclusive Development Group have been thoroughly pleasant, inspiring and enjoyable. I admire your theoretical literacy, eloquence and patience, and am excited about the prospects of further developing collaborative projects on water with you. Projects that combine scientific excellence with the desire to make a difference and that help breed a new kind of committed water experts. I also thank UNESCO IHE for welcoming me to the Institute. Looking back, I am grateful for the kind but firm efforts of Peter and the members of the Water Governance Group to convince me of applying. I thank them, as well as Charlotte and Stefan, for having made the process of transition from Wageningen to Amsterdam and Delft a smooth one. UNESCO IHE is an institute with a wonderfully diverse mix of extremely committed staff, and an even more wonderful and diverse group of students. That normalcy is always renegotiable is one of the nicest things about working at IHE and explains why I already feel that I belong. I look forward to further help the Institute achieving its mission, perhaps slightly changing it in the process. To my colleagues at the Water Governance Group, Frank, Zaki, Herman, Jeltje, Maarten, Klaas, Michel, Maria, Jaap, and Joyita, Nikki, Hebe and Michaela, you are the best. This is perhaps a good moment to recall that it is thanks to your Enrodantis efforts to carve out a space for critical social science within the Institute that the group exists. I will do my utmost best to protect and further strengthen this much-needed space in an environment of doers and solvers. Here we will need our UvA and King's College colleagues. It gives me great pleasure to be working with all of you, and I hope that we succeed in finding and creating time, energy and motivation to slow down. A slowing down that is needed to put our acquired wisdoms into words and for further developing a distinct new and relevant water voice. To my old friends and colleagues from Wageningen University, perhaps I do not miss the Wageningen University environment, but I do miss you. Let's continue to identify possibilities for working together and use the multiplication of our institutional affiliations as a source of strength rather than as one of alienation. Rutger, although we no longer share the same room, it is wonderful and somewhat miraculous that we again are close colleagues at the UvA. Stay close. To all PhD and MSc students I am working with and have worked with, thank you. Thank you for creativity, insights, and struggles. Your intimate and long-term dealings and engagements with water distributions are my most important source of intellectual inspiration. Make sure you never become disciplined. Allow me to also mention four persons who, each in their own way, have helped me discover my talents and ambitions, but who died too soon to be here today. Gerrit van Vuren, my former colleague, who saw a professor in me long before anyone else did. Jan Lever, my father-in-law, for whom belonging to his family automatically entitled me to a professorial title. Juus Lever, ze zou ze nog steeds geen cent geven. And Tommy, my dog, four-legged-shaped barking love is the better kind. My parents, Het en Giri, you have produced three opinioned, passionate, and strong-willed daughters. I am not sure whether that was the intention, but I, for one, would like to thank you for it. Imke and Ellen, weird sisters come in threesomes. Let's continue cherishing the sisterhood, the weirdness, as well as the threesomeness. Erik, Robert, Marianne, Sietse, Joost, Rutgert, thanks for existing, for being around, for caring, and perhaps most of all for making fun of and with me and challenging me. Everyone else, colleagues, friends, thank you. And finally, Anne, thank you, I love you. Ik heb gezegd.